This week on the Men at the Movies podcast, we dive into the 2005 film Kingdom of Heaven. We compare how our initiation mirrors Balion's experience. We discuss how investing 1% every day will, as C.S. Lewis says, produce a compound interest into who we are becoming. Our job is not to build a bigger kingdom, but to make sure the one we have is bursting with life. Join us as we discover God's truth in this movie.
The movies and stories we love are gateways to see ourselves and God in new ways.
Every great story borrows its power from a larger story. The story that's written on our hearts and woven into the fabric of our very being. Hello and welcome to the Men at the Movies podcast. My name is Paul McDonald, and joining me from across the world, we're going international with this baby, is Rob Porter. Hey, Rob, how you doing?
Hey, Paul. Great to be here, my friend.
We were discussing when we first got on the call, we were like, well, what time is it there? And for me now, it's about 5:30 in the evening. For you, it's about 9:30 in the morning. You've got your coffee going and...
Exactly. Yes. The kids are off at school now, so there's some quiet in the house.
Oh, yeah. That's important. That is important. I met Rob through the Become Good Soil through Morgan Snyder. We're have some mutual friends and mutual connections, and I got this email from him that said, "Hey, I don't know if you've done Kingdom of Heaven yet, but I'd love to get together and I'd love to do that." And that was a couple of weeks ago. And so now we finally got our schedules to align. And so Rob, I'm going to pitch you up the softball of why this movie, why do you love the Kingdom of Heaven, and why did you want to talk about it?
Yeah. Thanks, Paul. Great question. Well, I think it would be quite fitting actually, because Morgan Schneider has played a big part that connects to my story in this film. So I'd love to read just an excerpt from one of his blog posts, which is called Anything Anywhere, The Four Primary Questions for Masculine Initiation. And it goes like this. So the father's ongoing initiation of the masculine soul has the final word, inviting us and guiding us through this process of masculine initiation is mostly what God is up to in the life of every man. How will you respond to the Father's invitation to the boy within your own soul to be led by him through the initiation process of your masculine soul? He's kind enough to wait for the question and desire for initiation to arise in the heart. He is the initiator, and we are the ones invited and beckoned to respond to this wild love. God is perfectly capable of guiding you into initiation if this is what you want. So, Paul, the Father, for me, used this film really powerfully, amongst other things as well, to invite me into this holy process of initiation with him, which continues and will always continue on.
Yeah, as Morgan says, it's all prologue. It's all been
all prologue.
It's all initiation that leads us up to this point. And at some point, we're going to actually we'll get past the prologue, but probably not in this life.
Yeah. And I think in Balion's story, as we know, you know, seeing story unravel in film really helps us to connect to pieces in our own stories. And that's this epic for me. It's been a central piece in my initiation journey.
Initiation is in our kind of our Western culture today is a word that we might associate it with fraternities and hazing. So when you talk about initiation, what exactly are you talking about?
Okay. So one thing that someone put in front of me some time ago was a little sketch that you can find on Google if you type in the hero's journey. And it was just a really powerful, because I'm very visual, Paul. I learn by seeing and by doing. So it starts off like this. If you imagine a circle and let's say, Rob, I'm at the top of the circle and I start this journey where I'm being called into adventure, where I'm going through trials and failures and going through a death, going through round this circle into a death and a rebirth and a revelation and returning changed. I'm not the same person that I went into this process as.
Yeah.
And you think of all the men that we love in these films, you know, Balion in the Kingdom of Heaven goes through a process of initiation. In The Hobbit, you know, Gandalf says to Bilbo, you know, you'll have a tale or two to tell when you come back. And Bilbo says, you can promise that I'll come back. And Gandalf says, no, but if you do, you won't be the same. Mm. You know, the company men, Bobby, that you did with Morgan a few weeks ago, you know, goes through this rebirth. Mm-hmm. The Last of the Samurai, Captain Nathan Algren, King Arthur, Legend of the Sword, you know, Strider to Aragorn, William Wallace with his uncle Argyle, Neo in The Matrix, yep. You know, all these men, they've gone through something and they don't return the same. And yep. I'm really fascinated as we start to unpack Balian's story a bit more in the film, you know, just zooming in on parts of what this process has looked like for him, because he is... experience something from blacksmith to baron,
right? Right. And so we'll look at Balian's initiation, his preparation, because it's interesting, because he doesn't end up actually being the king. He's never crowned, he's never, you know, got that moment. However, he does take care of the people that are a part of his, where he considers the people under his authority.
Yes.
So we do, the movie starts and we find out that Balion is this blacksmith in this small village, and his wife and child have just died. And this guy comes up, he's going to the Crusades, and Liam Neeson's character shows up and he's the Baron. And he says, you're my son, I'm your father, and invites him to come with him.
Mm-hmm.
And Balion, you mentioned the hero's journey, and after, you know, that's his call to adventure. He gets invited to something, and initially he refused, I don't need you. Mm-hmm. But then he ends up deciding to follow, because he does have nothing there. His wife and child have died. He ends up killing the priest, because in the it's interesting, the religious characters in this film aren't very, what was it? There's a moment later where they said, those guys are dying for something that the Pope would command.
Mm-hmm.
And the hospitaler, who's played by, I can never remember his name, but he played Lupin in the Harry Potter films. Yes. And he says, but not Christ, I think.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and these guys are very pharisaical. They're about taking care of themselves. And that's what this priest comes in and he says horrible, hurtful things and is about his wife, and because his wife had committed suicide. And so Balion decides to go to Jerusalem to find forgiveness for himself and for his wife.
Mm.
He goes to see his father, and some beautiful scenes that we couldn't clip because there was a lot of fighting, which is, it's visually great. Less so on audio, but this whole mindset that the king, the Baron, was preparing him for who he would become, which I think when we talk about initiation, that's sort of what that is our preparation for who we are becoming.
Mm. Yeah. And I think a quote here that stood out to me, Paul, as I was marinating in this for a while. And another thing to mention here as well, you know, connecting intimately in the mythic has been a real powerful exercise to pursue. So, for example, you know, I'm holding up a photograph to Paul at the moment, which is Godfrey, Balian's dad, putting his sword at the ready when some people come looking to take Balion, essentially. Looking at marinating in these pictures, these scenes, for a while, you know, pinning them up somewhere and saying, Lord, what is it you're trying to speak to me through this scene here into my story? I find that really powerful. But one quote that stood out to me, Paul, was by John Eldredge, our dear ally, in his book, Fathered by God. And he very, very rightly caught up on the reality of the result of having abandoned masculine initiation is a world of unfinished, uninitiated men. And we're not saying through this conversation, you need to, you know, get a sword out and shield. But allow God to speak to what he might want to say to you through this conversation, through this film.
Because initiation looks different for every person. And, absolutely. And one of the things you mentioned that the law came up pursuing Balion and said, he murdered a priest. We're taking him with us. And his father said, no, I don't think so. He's coming on the Crusades with us. And so the battle ensued, and Balion said to his father, he said, they had a right to take me.
Yeah.
And his father said, so do I.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because to get all like super scriptural or super spiritual or whatever, the law has certain rights.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, we've, as it says, we've all sinned. We're all broken. We're all, you know, have these shattered pieces of us. We're not wholehearted men. And yet if we fell by the law and the judgment, then they have a right to us. But what happens through the power of the gospel is God comes, and through Jesus and his sacrifice, his taking our place, the Father comes and says, I have a right to them too.
Mm-hmm.
And because the debt has been paid, my rights supersede the law's rights.
Mm-hmm.
And so he takes this broken person, you know, you and I, we've got issues. Yeah. And I'm going to play a clip because the Baron in the fight, he actually takes a wound that's going to kill him. And he says, you're going to go to Jerusalem. You're going to go see the king. And I think when we look at God and we look at our lives, we ask the same question that Balion asks his father.
Do you know what lies in the Holy Land? A new world. A man who in France had not a house, is in the Holy Land the master of a city. He who was the master of a city begs in the gutter. There, at the end of the world, you are not what you were born, but what you have it in yourself to be.
I hope to find forgiveness. That's all I know.
Whatever your position, you are of my house, and that means you will serve the King of Jerusalem.
What could a king ask of a man like me?
A better world than has ever been seen. A kingdom of conscience. A kingdom of heaven.
What could a king do with a man like me?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I love that other question. I go to Jerusalem to seek forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's what the gospel is frequently painted as. Jesus died to save your sins and will go to heaven when you die.
Mm-hmm.
Which is great when we die. but what about the between? What about, you know, there could be decades, right? Mm-hmm. Between that moment of salvation and getting to heaven. So so going back to that whole idea, it's our time of initiation. What is, because the king sees in us something, you know, what is it that, it's, you become the man you were born. It's not like what you are, or it's not what you do, but who you are that will determine the outcome.
Yes. And what's interesting, Paul, as well, kind of going back to Balion's, when he's a blacksmith on the beam of wood, in the roof, it says, "What man is a man who does not make the world better?" What I love about that is it's a real, I wonder what effect that had on Balion, seeing that day in, day out through his childhood. And then he meets his dad, who starts to talk a bit like this. These threads, these holy threads coming together, you know, this father coming looking for his son in the dirt and in the pain and in the suffering and at the brink of death, and says, "Come this way, we can find out together." Wow.
It's interesting because before we recorded, we talked for a little while, and we were talking about sort of our own initiation and what that looks like. And that whole idea of make the world a better place. Mm. You mentioned a book, The Man Who Plants Trees, and it's a great, it's a kid's book, or it's at least made to look like a kid's book, but it's about this guy who goes around and plants trees. And through his planting of trees, he transforms the countryside, the landscape of where he is. It turns from a desolate, dry, dusty, abandoned wilderness into a place that's lush, and people are growing, and people are, you know, things are growing, and people are moving there, and it's pleasant, and there's water. And like I said, it's a great little story.
Yes.
And I'm not saying that to minimize it, because both of us have read it, and it's got a lot of layers, and it's very deep.
Yeah.
And so I loved what you shared. I'm going to put you on the spot here and ask about this, that idea of the world a better place. So will you share about the acorns and the 1%?
Sure. So after reading this book a few times and speaking to a few friends, this kind of idea popped up of what would it look like to gather some acorns. So I have a jar right here. My trusty acorns are now really brown. And I wrote 1% on each of these acorns. And I was explaining to Paul how, so if in my day I rearrange, let's say a work meeting to go and pick my daughter up from school and take her for an ice cream or something. Something that's important, something that's the most important thing, a good investment. I'll put one of these acorns in the jar. And for me, it's like an easy, sustainable way each day to see visually that a great good is unfolding, that my choices have an impact.
Yes.
And I'm becoming more responsible and owning my choices better. I'm still very much a student, an apprentice, and making mistakes and learning as we all are. But this has just been a helpful rhythm of reconstruction in my choice making.
Who we are is reflected in our daily choices. And that whole idea of, well, what can I do to make the world better? And you can't, you know, this isn't a striving, chasing, pursuing sort of thing. I had a friend of mine text me today, and he's looking back over his adult child's life. And he's like, did I do enough to show Jesus to him?
Mm.
And that question, I was like, that's a good question, but is that enough? Was I enough? Because if you're looking for that outside, external, what did I do? What would say that he was enough?
Yes.
Other than the words of his father. And so going back to the movie, Balion, his father is on his deathbed. And he has done, you know, he's still learning the sword. He's still learning, you know, he's been a blacksmith in a small leader shop. Yes. Or a small village shop. But his father sees who he can be. Yeah. And he kind of speaks these words, these oaths to make him a knight.
Be without fear in the face of your enemies. Be brave and upright that God may love thee. Speak the truth always, even if it leads to your death. Safeguard the helpless and do no wrong. That is your oath.
Arise, knight and baron of Ibelin.
And Balion hadn't done anything to earn that. But it was still bestowed on him. Because it's very easy for us to say, was it enough? Did I do enough? You know, in Balian's case, he's searching for forgiveness. And then when he eventually arrives at Jerusalem, he goes to the hill where Jesus was crucified, according to the story. And he says he didn't hear from God. God was silent. He's lost God, which I thought was, he's like, I've lost my religion. And the hospitaler, who's the Lupin character, he's sort of like an angel type thing or the Holy Spirit, but he's just like, I hadn't heard that. Like he's like, yeah, I hadn't heard that God had abandoned you. I just think that that's our perspective when we go through these challenging times. Like for him, think of that. He's coming off the death of his daughter, his wife and child. He discovers a father who's a baron, which ranks higher on the whole job category. And then he loses him. And what does he have now other than a ring and an oath that he is a knight? You know, the ring of the baron.
I love, Paul, the power of, and we'll get to this later in the film as well, but the bestowing of identity and being given a new name.
Yeah.
Being invited up into this cause greater than himself. You know, it seems like these few scenes have been quite fast, but maybe there's been months in between these scenes in real life, let's say, you know, where this process has marinated in Balion with his brief time with his real father. Speaking of rings, so I have a ring here that someone gave to me and bestowed it to me in a fellowship of men. And this film was one of the pieces that that God used to invite me to pursue that. But like, not like Balion, but maybe 1% understanding of Balian's story. I've had a ring placed on my finger by somebody else, by someone older, by someone who is further down the rabbit hole than me. And it's powerful. It's powerful. It's transformative. It calls you up. It calls you higher out of this self-life and into a larger, much larger story. So I just love this scene.
Because the things that he said were basically, it's not about you. It's protect the helpless. Speak the truth. Don't be afraid. You know, be bold. And again, a lot of these things that the Baron told Balion are things that God tells us. You know, there's all kinds of, you know, do not fear, be of good courage, all this throughout the Bible. Like, I don't know, a lot of hundreds of times those words are in the Bible. And then you talk about how to treat each other in love. And that includes, you know, don't lie. Don't give in to the manipulation of as the political scene that he will enter with the nobles and the kings and the lords.
Yes.
And so he goes to Jerusalem and he meets the king, and the king has a sit down with him. And I just thought that it was a really interesting conversation about maintaining or navigating the situation that he found himself.
Yes.
None of us choose our end, really. A king may move a man. A father may claim a son. But remember that even when those who move you be kings or men of power, your soul is in your keeping alone. When you stand before God, you cannot say, but I was told by others to do thus, or that virtue was not convenient at the time. This will not suffice. Remember that.
I will.
Then go now to your father's house at Ebelin, and from there protect the pilgrim road. Protect the helpless. And then perhaps one day, when I am helpless, you will come and protect me.
No, by the way, that was Edward Norton.
Was that Edward Norton?
Yes.
You know what, Paul? I looked at the cast and I saw Edward Norton. I was like, I don't remember seeing him.
Yeah, it was, right, you know, okay. So you've got Liam Neeson, you've got Orlando Bloom, you've got Ed Norton, you've got, you know, Lupin, you've got Hamish from Braveheart.
It's a great
lot
cast.
It was a big cast. Yeah.
Yeah.
But this idea of you've got to guard your heart, which again, another theme that keeps popping up. You are the one responsible for your soul.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to be, you know, we don't choose our end. And in this world, you know, we've lived with COVID now for over right around a year and a half. And
yes,
people have all sorts of reactions and responses. But that idea, we don't control our end.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, even Jesus talked about that. What man can add a day to his life through all this striving and work, and that idea of we could chase the validation. We can chase the enoughness to make up a word. Because that idea of a good man leaves the world a better place. And we could spend our lives trying to do that and still miss the point.
Yeah, that's huge, Paul. I think one connection here as well is that, you know, Balion didn't want anything from his father. He had learned father wrong. You know, he needed to go through this process of unlearning that which was false. And we hear Morgan Schneider at Become Good Soil talk about this. Unlearning that which is false and relearning that which is true. Balion's learning more and more and more about what is true here. You know, he meets the king. The king says Balion's dad was one of his greatest teachers. Wow. Imagine a son hearing that from a king. You'd be like, wow, okay, my dad's the real deal. Flip. No pressure on me. Yeah. his dad has a good name. His dad has got a good name. The king asked Balion, were you sure of your end once? Like, were you sure how you were going to die? And Balion says, yes. He thought he was going to be buried 100 yards from where he was born. And the king says to Balion, and now? And Balion said, now I sit in Jerusalem and look upon a king. And I just said, wow, you know, his world has dramatically widened to possibility. His aperture has just been exponentially increased by unlearning that which is false and relearning that which is true. And this goes back to the whole process of initiation.
Because it'd be really easy to hold on to the hurt and the anger of, oh, you know, he's what, 30 years old and by the time the movie starts, and now his dad shows up and he even says in that moment, I don't want anything from you. And he goes on his way. He said, I'll be going this route. If you change your mind, you know where you can find me.
Mm-hmm.
And it is in our choices to pursue, because all throughout the New Testament, there is this idea of maturation and what we have to go through to mature.
Yes.
And to grow and to become stronger. And it's not easy. Like, none of the stuff, like, you know, Balion got, there was that big fight and then he got shipwrecked and then he watched his father die. And then he gets, you know, he has a mortal enemy in Guy, the bad guy in the movie, who wants to pick a fight with the Muslims. And because he said, well, they're not of us, they're not of God, so they must die, basically. And all this is probably not something he would say. Yeah, I really want to be shipwrecked and fight for my life over a horse to save me from the desert. And yet it's something that he went through that would have, you know, those 1% shifts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's even something C.S. Lewis talks about, those 1%. We don't have to make a decision of, should I keep my job or go to the mission field?
Yes.
It's, do I work late or do I spend time with my daughter? Do I take my daughter out for ice cream or have dinner with my family?
Yes.
Those are those 1% shifts that, until they become a part of us, our decisions, and then they become, well, no, that's just the way I do it. That's just who I am.
Mm.
And you see that when he does. So the king had said, Balion, go to your father's house, and he gets there and he sees dry, dusty.
Oh yeah.
And the line was, your father was important. Mm. His lands were not.
Yeah.
And again, Balion, he keeps being faced with situations where he has a choice.
Yeah.
Like he could sit there and say, oh, this is all my dad left me, or, you know, it's dry, dusty, it sucks, and just sort of say it sucks.
Mm-hmm.
But what does he do? He says, this, what we're lacking, we've got plenty of people, we've got plenty of, you know, animals. What we're lacking is water.
Mm.
And as the Baron, he could say, hey, go dig some wells. But he got in the wells. He was digging. He was the one. And they said, oh, we found water. And he goes over running and is like, yeah, let's, you know, set it up. And he set up irrigation. And then, you know, it turns into a green, very similar to the man who planted trees. It turns into a garden.
Yes.
And he changed it. And Sibylla, who is Guy's wife, and she's in line to be queen because she's the king's brother. So when the king dies, and oh, by the way, the king has leprosy, so that's why we didn't know it was Edward Norton, because he had the mask on and stuff. When the king dies, she will be queen, and that makes Guy king. And Guy, remember, he's a bad guy.
Mm-hmm.
Well, she shows up and she talks about how he's made that place, his dry, dusty, unimportant land, into a new Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
He says, well, that's what I do. That's remember going back to that, the statement in his shop, I'm leaving my place a better place.
Mm.
And you see that in each time he sort of faces a situation, like he said, oh, I thought I was serving the king, and now you're sending me away to this dry, dusty farm.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't get frustrated with his assignment. He just does it to the best of his ability.
Mm. Mm-hmm. There's so much power, isn't there? I'm just struck as you're talking, Paul, of the redemptive power of learning father right. You know, we talked earlier, just a moment ago, about unlearning that which is false and relearning that which is true. And, you know, Balian's dad came for him. But as we know, or have come to know and realize, that our earthly relationship with our dad has a profound impact on how we view Father God.
Mm-hmm.
So if we have got tangled with our biological fathers, which I'm sure a lot of us have, I know I have, but to unlearn that which is false and to relearn that which is true is transformational. And we see this in Balian's in life here, like Balian's being entrusted with little.
Yeah.
To begin with, you know, the king says, go to your dad's land, look after things, look after his affairs there for a bit, and then we'll see how the story goes, see what happens. But yeah, Balian's posture, you know, this land will suit me. What we don't have is water. You know, bringing life and care to what's been entrusted to him.
Mm.
Taking an interest in all people, and looking after them. You know, he's got their best interest at heart. I love Balian's purity into the story, Paul, because it seems like there's been a lot of people have just been corrupted by power and land grabbing and money grabbing. And then you've got Balian, who's been like a blacksmith for years. And then, you know, as Morgan coins another sort of phrase, I believe, which is like, you know, when the student's ready, the teacher appears. And I just love that. I love that the moment that Balian's dad comes for him, you know, Balian has got a good heart. You know, he's a good man. And it's just all flowing out now. And it's just really joyful to see that. You know, we read kings in the Bible where you can see if there's a bad king or a good king, because whichever coin that is, the people either thrive or don't. You know, they're in pain, they're suffering under a bad king. They're thriving, they're happy and glad in the rule of a good king.
And I think, like you said, is that whole idea of learning father wrong. And I have another friend who's has felt pressure to do something great for God because he's afraid that when he's like, I don't want to get to heaven. And instead of getting that, well done, my good and faithful servant, be like, yeah, you did okay. I gave you all these opportunities, but you didn't do anything with it. And that fear of disappointing it can drive us. Just like my buddy who was worried about the past 20 something years with his son. And did he show Jesus enough? Because the truth is, we can't do anything about the past. We can't change it. We can't change what's happened. We can't do anything different. But what we can do is, well, I can't do that, but what can I do? What, you know, and I told my buddy, I was like, well, how can you show him Jesus' love today? How can you ask God, say, how he is initiating your son? And how can you partner with that? Because this idea, and I know I've had it, of my kids would be better off if they had a different dad sort of mindset. But that idea in Ephesians 2:10, and I've sort of, it's the New Living Translation, and I've kind of personalized it a little bit. For you are God's masterpiece. He created you anew in Christ Jesus, so you can do the good things he planned for you long ago. So if you look at Balian, we spiritualize these things because they're stories, they're parables. God planned for Balian to arrive at that moment so that those people would get the water and so that they would have somebody to look after them. And in those moments, and again, I'm not trying to, you know, talk about super crazy God sovereignty stuff, but we think that we're not prepared for what happens. But the truth is that even the stuff that whether it's the stuff we're proud of or the stuff we're ashamed of, God uses both. He redeems it all for his purposes and for the good of the people that are his, right? So even my mistakes as dad, God will redeem it and use my mistakes to bring my children closer to him. He's like, yeah, you might think you screwed up, but that was just the right thing to nudge them in this direction to see me.
Yes.
Which is kind of, it should free us to be, as you mentioned, to become more mature, to realize it's not up to us. And as you mentioned, he got entrusted with a little and the king calls Balian back. They're going to go to war with the Muslims. And in this situation, and honestly, he doesn't want to. The king doesn't want to. He wants to live in peace with everyone.
Yeah.
Which I think is a pretty good, good goal to have, right? And it reminded me of when David gets called up and they have this big political manipulation of they wanted Balian to come to be king. And they were basically going to kill Gi off. And Balian, again, has a choice. How is he going to guard his heart?
Yes.
So, my friend, the time has come to conclude my affairs. We have decided that you shall take command of the army of Jerusalem. If I leave the army with Guy, he will take power through my sister and make war on the Muslims.
Whatever you ask, I will serve.
No, hear it all before you answer. Would you marry my sister, Sibylla, were she free of Guy de Lusignan?
And Guy?
He would be executed. Along with his knights who do not sway allegiance.
I cannot be the cause of that.
Whatever you ask, I will serve.
A king may move a man, you said. But the soul belongs to the man.
Yes, I did.
You have my love and my answer.
Oh, so be it.
Why is he protecting you? He's a man who insults you, hates you, would kill you himself if he had the chance. But for the salvation of this kingdom, would it be so hard to marry Sibylla? Jerusalem has no need of a perfect knight.
No. It is a kingdom of conscience or nothing.
Who are you to refuse a king? I am what I am. I offer you that. And the world. You say no.
Do you think I'm like Guy? That I would sell my soul?
There'll be a day when you will wish you had done a little evil to do a greater good.
Ooh, my goodness. Goodness me. Wow. That's huge, isn't it, Paul?
Yeah. So how are you, what's going on inside as you're responding to that clip?
Oh man, a number of things really. I think Sibylla was married to Guy when she was 15. I'm just wondering at the damage that would have been done to her over that time. Mm. In terms of like, she's seen this man make decisions, treat women, you know, go about his affairs in everyday life. And he's not a good man. Then this guy Balion comes along into the scene, who has morals and honor and a conscience and a taking care of his soul and looking after people and treating people well. Must have really messed with Sibylla. in a profoundly good and holy way. And we know later in the film that does have an impact on her in a profound way. But I think of Jesus being tested, you know?
Yeah.
The world can be yours. You can have everything. It's all yours. You've just got to say yes. But there's enough in Balion to remember what's true here. To remember his dad's voice and to follow that voice. He doesn't need to think about it either, Paul, to the king. He even recites back to the king what the king advised him.
Right.
The soul belongs to the man. So I just really love that moment. There's just, yeah. How about you, Paul? What kind of comes to you with that moment?
Well, as you mentioned, it's what his dad had said, what the Baron had said. It's a kingdom of conscience. And that's what he says. It's a kingdom of conscience or it's nothing.
Mm.
If I put a little bit of poison in a cup of water, it's like, it's just a little poison. It's not all poison.
Mm-hmm.
And we think that we take that into our souls when we don't guard it and protect it and decide for it.
Yes.
And it could be, it's just a little more food. It's just a little more time at the office. It's just one more look, one more, you know, computer website visit, one more fist through the wall. There's a lot of things. One more little white lie to protect the greater good. But the greatest good is our soul, is our heart. I mean, nothing is more valuable than that. The heavens rejoice over one new believer, over somebody coming from death to life.
Yes.
And Balion knew that. And I loved in the video scene when Sibylla comes to him. And by the way, the end was Sibylla coming into him and be like, who are you to refuse a king and me? And she goes to kiss him and he shifts his jaw. It was a little more than 1 degree, but it was, it was not much, just enough to not return the kiss. And he said, who would I be? Am I like ghee to sell my soul? It's like, yeah, I could do, because that's the thing. Do a little evil to do a greater good. But it doesn't work like that. Yes. Because as you mentioned, it changes who we are. And he's not Balion if he does that.
Yeah. And Tiberius, I think Tiberius slightly earlier on, you know, reveals his shame. And Tiberius is a good man.
Yeah.
But he reveals his shame to Balion, which was, you know, at first we thought we were fighting for God. Then we were fighting for wealth and land.
And it doesn't happen overnight. Like I've worked in the emergency department. And I saw a guy come in and he had overdosed. And this was like 8, 9 in the morning. And I just remember I'm in there talking to him and he's crushed. And this idea of, I bet you never thought you'd wake up like this. And you wake up and you say, how did I get here?
Yes.
And it is, it's in those 1 degree shifts that add up over time. We came out here pursuing God. We thought this was God's will. And now it's just all about wealth and lands and power. And it could be about money or vacations or prestige. Fill in the blank for whatever it could be. But for Balion, he's protecting his heart. He's protecting his soul. And bad things happen when Guy becomes king and he goes off and fights the Muslims and the whole army gets slaughtered and they're coming to take Jerusalem back and there's a siege and the priest there first, he's like, oh, we should head out the door and leave the people to themselves. It's like, what is wrong with you? And then it gets to this point where he's like, how are we going to defend the city without knights? And Balion, because when we have our identity bestowed, when we have been initiated, we have power to then pass that on, much as you mentioned the older mentor who bestowed a ring on you. And now Balion has words of life to give to the men around him.
Yes.
Every man at arms, all capable of bearing them, kneel! On your knees! Be without fear in the face of your enemies. Be brave and upright that God may love thee. Speak the truth, even if it leads to your death. Safeguard the helpless. That is your oath. And that is so you remember it. Rise a knight! Rise a knight! Who do you think you are? Will you alter the world? Doesn't making a man a knight make him a better fighter?
Yes.
Who do you think you are? You're going to alter the world.
Significant moment, Paul. Significant moment. You know, you hear Balion say, we protect the city not to protect the stones, but the people living within these walls.
Yeah.
And I love this a quote by G.K. Chesterton, which says, the true soldier fights not because he hates what's in front of him, but because of he loves what's behind him.
Yeah.
And I really, I just love how masculinity bestows masculinity. He can now offer what he's received. You know, Morgan, to quote him in numerous times in this, he's been one of our powerful mentors and guides and dear friend in this journey. Yeah. So we can't not but bring his name into this. You can't offer what you have not received. And what I love is now he's already a knight. He's been knighted. And he knights a whole community of men. He's given them a new name. He's bestowed identity like his father did to him and called them up into a greater cause than themselves. And you can see, can't you, Paul, on the film, for those that have seen it will know what I'm about to describe. But if you have not seen this film, please do, because it's a great scene. And you see the camera, when the priest says to Balion, do you think making a man a knight makes him a better fighter? There's a moment where the camera goes to the faces of these men around what Balian's just done. And it's visceral. You can see a difference.
Yeah.
You can see it. There's been a change. There's been a transaction. How about you, Paul? What kind of stirs in your heart with that scene?
Well, it reminds me of the scene in 300 where Leonidas shows up with his 300 men. And he shows up and meets one of his allies, and his ally is disappointed. And he said, I thought you were going to bring more warriors. I thought you were going to match our output. You know, he had maybe 1,000 guys. And so Leonidas looks, he's like, you there, what do you do? I'm a potter. Well, what do you do? Sculptor. I'm a baker. And he turns around and he says, you know, men of Sparta, what is your profession? And they go, oh, because he brought 300 warriors.
Yeah.
And you're right. You see that as Balion calls that out in the men around him.
Mm.
It's like, you see yourself as a servant, as a page, as a, you know, errand boy, as a baker or whatever.
Mm.
But I'm bestowing you the honor of knight, and I'm giving you the duty to protect mm-hmm. this city, to protect the people.
Mm.
And I think Jesus does the same thing for us. He says, go and pursue. And the early apostles took care of the orphans and the widows and the people who didn't have enough. And they gave whatever, if anybody was in need, they would give to that. And they would pursue them with love. You know, that mm-hmm. whole thing of, if we chase after making the world a better place, you know, Paul talks about it in 1 Corinthians 13. If I do all that,
yes.
but don't love the people I'm doing it for,
mm.
then I'm just wasting my time.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
And you see that he reminds them of who they could be,
mm.
of what he sees in them. As you mentioned, the masculinity is bestowing masculinity on those young men who looked up to him and they were inspired.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you're around the presence of someone like that,
mm.
and mm. as you mentioned, again, going back to your ceremony where your mentor gave you the ring,
mm.
it means something. It lifts you up
mm-hmm.
to say, this is who I am.
Mm.
Just like my buddy who was struggling with his son. Well, yes. that's not who you are. Sure. You weren't perfect. Nobody is. We're not perfect.
Mm.
But you did you loved your son the best you could. You made hard decisions.
Mm.
That whole question of, am I enough?
Mm. Mm-hmm.
comes out. And And the Father, God, looks down on us, says, you are because I made you. I have a role for you to play that only you can fill if you're bold enough to do it. If you can protect your heart so that you can do the things I've called you to do, so that you don't lose heart.
Mm-hmm.
And the enemy will try to take you out.
Yeah.
To say, yeah, look, there's a woman over there who'd love to for you to be her husband. There's an army who would love for you to be their general. There's a country who would love for you to be their king.
Mm-hmm. I often wonder, Paul, David in the Bible and the scene with Bathsheba. I often wonder if Jonathan was alive, would that have happened? I wonder if he had that close, intimate ally. Because that's what it means to be walking with close, intimate allies in a community of men, which has been assaulted very heavily. Going after the recovery of that has changed my life. And would you say the same for you, Paul?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And again, we talked about this, but this sense of rest of, you know, I've got brothers in the battle. So when, you know, it hits the fan,
and
I've got guys who say, hey man, this is going on. I'm not sure where to go. I'm not sure what to do. And even, I think I screwed up and they say, no, this is who you are. And they help remind you of your true heart, your true identity.
Yes.
Well, or to call you and say, that probably isn't a good idea. I think you're chasing after that kingdom now. And maybe you should just bring water to the land that you're working on. Instead of trying to get a bigger kingdom, bring water to where you are.
Yeah. It's powerful to help remember who you were and who you're becoming, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
I love Tiberius when he says, you know, you are your father's son. People are noticing, all these people that know Godfrey, Balian's dad, see what Balian's doing, see his character, see who he's becoming, you know. Hospitaller says to him, you know, I'll tell your father what I've seen you become.
Yeah.
It's like, wow.
Because he's going off to certain death. And Hospitaller says, all death is certain.
Yes.
But when I see your father, I'll tell him what you've become. It isn't, as Christians, as followers of Jesus, isn't that what we're, people should see our father in us.
Yes.
And we should bring life to those around us, not death and misery and pressure. And
that's where this process of initiation changes a man. When they enter in, they won't return the same. And what I so, what gives me hope each day, Paul, is the more that we become, and it is a strenuous apprenticeship, you know, disclosure. But oh my goodness, as we know, all these men that we admire have gone through something. And I really desire to keep going through something, Paul. This holy initiation with God, fathering me, because my two daughters will benefit. You know, everyone in my care, anyone I ever meet in the future will benefit from me becoming more of who I am.
Well, that was awesome. Rob, thank you for joining me here on the podcast. And I don't know if we said exactly where you're from, down in New Zealand. Land of the Lord of the Rings down there where they film the movies. And so appreciate your time and your thoughts and sharing your heart with us today.
Yeah, Paul, a real honor to have a conversation with you. Really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Well, thanks for joining us. And thank you guys for listening. If you enjoy this podcast and you'd like to support us, visit our Patreon page. We're at patreon.com/minutethemovies. Look for ways that you can partner with us. You might even get invited to a live stream or even get to be invited on the show. Also, check out our website, menatthemovies.com/podcast, where we have, we'll talk about some quotes and themes and have questions if you want to sort of dig a little bit deeper into the themes that Rob and I brought up today. So I hope you enjoyed it, and we hope you join us next week here on the Men at the Movies podcast.
Something inside has been awakened. I can no longer be who I was before. But if I am no longer who I was, who am I to be?